Die volgende geselsprogram bevat soms unieke idees wat nie vir almal se denke is nie, asook gekryde taal wat nie vir almal se ore is nie. Wees gewaarsku. Kyk,
ek hoor jou almal altyd sê raai het my weer. Ja, nog te hoor ek dit nie. Soms hoor ek maar net en almal is
nie. Dit is die 15de Mei. Jy luister na Klets. 15, kan jy dit glo? 15. Daar het my ook nou sy gat gesien.
Ja, nee, Matthijs, kom ons wees hoopvol. Hy is nou slap bang in the middle. Ja. So as jy 'n bietjie geleen snoes het vir die laaste 15 dae. Jy het nog hoeveel dae het my? Dan 31, nee?
31.
Jy het nog 16 dae oor. Jy het nog 16 dae oor. To work your magic, baby. Onthou, ja, so, onthou net wat ons laas week gesê het. The magic lies in things that you're avoiding.
Ja, daar's 'n paar goeders wat ek avoid nog steeds. Ek het nog nie daai my eie poison gedrink nie. Maar een ding wat ons nie kan avoid nie is verkiesing. So daar is nog, wat is dit? 13 dae dan. Is ek reg? 13 dae, 29. Ja,
vra jy my nou om jou bevrekening te check.
13 dae oor.
Dis is om die standaard graad wiskunde kind in die klas van die laer graad wiskunde kind nou vra vir advies. Het gaan nie werk nie.
So 13 dae se elektrisiteit wat ons nog het, hè? Is jy
yes,
nie happy oor dit?
Julle geniet dit.
Geniet dit.
Van alles nie uit aan.
Geniet dit. Geniet dit. Ramagopa sê natuurlik dat mense soos ek byvoorbeeld nou wat nie broers is, soos wat hy dit sê, wat beweer
wat,
dat Eskom
wat nie broers.
'N nie broer. Soos 'n ja-broer of 'n
nee-broer.
Ek is 'n nee-broer wat sê dat Eskom verbrand uitlok 'n magdom diesel om kunsmatig beerkrag voor die algemene verkiesing te verminder, sê hy, en dit is nou, hy praat nou van my, nê? Nee? Hy sê
ja,
ek nee-broer. Is 'n nee-broer en ek is hoogs onbekwaam of ongemaklik met verandering. Dit begin dan.
Nee, Ramagopa, ons hou baie van verandering, maar dan moet dit positief en vooruitstrewend wees. Ons hou nie van agteruitgang nie. So as dit jou definisie is van verandering. Ek sien vandag, ek vergeet nou haar naam of gister het ek 'n berig gelees wat ek dink dit was Business Tech wat dit uitgebring het.
Ja.
Oor dit hulle sê die vrou wat Eskom aan die gang hou.
Ja,
vroue ingenieur.
Ja, 'n jongerige, blanke blonde girl. Blonke, 'n blonke vrou.
Blonke, weet jy hoe?
Ja.
Dit is nie eintlik baie so jonk nie, Matthijs. So die foto wat, dit was hilarious actually. Die foto wat, wat Business Tech op die caption gesit op hulle social media, like sy nogal vir my soos 'n Karen, which I like. Want ek dink ons het actually bietjie meer Karens in regering nodig.
Jy's reg. Sy doen nogal, sy lyk 'n bietjie soos 'n Karen.
Ja, in hierdie... Maar as jy nou die berig oopmaak en jy lees, dan kry jy nou 'n foto van waar sy nou onlangs 'n publieke toespraak gelewer het. Sy is nog steeds 'n beautiful vrou, maar definitief nie meer so jonk soos die foto wat hulle mee gespog het op die clickbait nie. Ja,
ja, nou dat jy sê, sy lyk nogal soos Karen.
Miskien het ons meer van hulle nodig.
En sy het so bietjie 'n vars gespykerde voorkoms.
Ja, ja, ja.
Wat Hanu... Hanen
sal trots wees.
Hanen seker vir haar opgedis het daar voor een of ander fotosession. Hoorie, dis 'n besige dag hier aan ons kant. Ons praat nou met die bekroonde Prof Blok. David
ja,
Blok.
Professor David Blok, bekroonde sterrekundige. Publiseerder, navorser en ja, een van ek dink net twee mense wat my starstruck kry.
Ja, starstruck, but we also gonna talk about the stars and we gonna do it again in English in Brits. Ja.
Ons gaan weer 'n bietjie Brits vandag, Matthijs, met ons
gaan weer 'n bietjie Brits
sterre ambassadeur.
Bietjie hoor, dis natuurlik.
Ek kan tog te mooi Brits hoor. Ek kan tog te mooi Brits.
Ek sien baie uit om bietjie te leer oor presies wat gebeur het, want dit is die afgelope naweek die hulle noem dit 'n die sonstorm. Ek sukkel verskriklik met woorde vandag.
Dis so wel ek kan jou dalk nie help nie. Daar's ook nou weer eens die standaardgraad en laergraad kind in die Afrikaanse klas. Fok, dit gaan roffie. Maar ja, kom ons roep hom maar net Engels, die solar flare storm.
Solar flare storm, ek het iewers gelees in Afrikaans praat hulle van die sonstorm. So ons gaan 'n bietjie by hom hoor oor dit, wat het gebeur, hoekom het dit gebeur? Hoekom gebeur dit net elke lyk my omtrent 21 jaar is hy op siklus, die son, dan poep hy en dan sien ons kleure in die lig. So hy gaan vir ons verduidelik hoekom poep die son. En dan natuurlik was dit ook Moedersdag. Colleen, het jy lekker Moedersdag gehad?
Ek moes vroeër die week met my moeder gaan celebrate, want ek het eintlik 'n ander geleentheid gehad wat ek toe nou klaar voor ge-RSVP het.
Ja, ek sien jy beide.
Dis Moedersdag. Huh? Ja.
Ek en jy beide, jy het net vroeger geloop as ek, so my lewer is een bietjie meer geskend as jou nou.
Ek onthou, ek het altyd so vriend gehad en hy het altyd vir my gesê, so ou wys vriend, hy het altyd vir my gesê, hy hoop net altyd, al verloor hy alles in sy lewe, dat die Here vir hom altyd die gawe skenk om te weet wanneer om te gaan. So ja, ek verstaan, nou al hoe beter wat hy bedoel het met daai wysheid. Maar ja, my ma was so gracious oor die hele storie, ek moet sê.
Okay.
Ja, sy sê vir my nee, maar dis geval geen probleem nie, want ek maak elke dag Moedersdag.
Oh. Hoe cute is jy nie, Colleen?
Ek wil dit nou nie op my, die lig op my fokus nie, maar ja, that's what she said.
Weet jy, maar ma's is nogal slim goeders, nee? En hulle leer gewoonlik vir kinders, maar meeste van die tyd, 'n paar goed. So, hier is 'n lysie van 'n paar goeders wat ma's vir kinders leer. So, ma leer kinders om te bid. En dit kom gewoonlik, as hulle vir jou sê, jy moet bid dat daardie kol uit die mat uit is, as ek vanaand thuis kom. So, dis die een. Jou ma leer jou om te time travel. Hier, laat ek dit eens sluk fyn vat. Wat gaan aan?
Jy, doe net iets daar. Doe net iets daar.
Okay, cheers. Okay, so ma's leer jou om te time travel. Is gewoonlik as hulle vir jou sê, ek sal jou tot in volgende week inklap. dan leer ma's ook vir kinders dat pa's baie slimmer en ryker is as ma's, want hulle sê altyd, gaan vra vir jou pa. Jy weet, daar is die volgende ene.
Dan beter pa die regte antwoord gee, want anders is hy ook in die moeilikheid.
Ja, dan is hy in die moeilikheid by ma, en by die, dan is dit 'n familie chaos, dan is dit 'n orgie. Dan, hulle leer jy ook van plantkunde, wat hulle vir jou sê, lyk het of geld op my rug groei.
Ek het daai nie gesien kom nie, ja.
Dan leer hulle jou ook om nederig en klein te wees. Vir alles hulle vir jou sê, meneerkie. Dan is het so.
Juffroukie,
meneerkie, kiekie, kiekies, kiekie, klein kiekie mense. Ek het mos 'n probleem met hulle, as hulle in verkleiningsforme praat. Dan, hulle leer jou van die weer, as hulle vir jou sê, dit lyk of daar 'n dekselse orkaan jou kamer getref het, dan leer jy jou van fauna en flora. Moenie my vertel dat perre kak vye is nie. Ek weet nie of jou ma ooit dit vir jou gesê het nie.
Nee, my ma was nie so gracious as sy vir my wou sweets oorbring. Sy het ook byvoorbeeld ook gesê die orkaan in my kamer nie. Sy het sommer vir my vinnig van die prostitusie beroep ook gelees, maar gesê, like sy hoerse handsakkie binne.
dan leer hulle ook om jouself te ontdek. Hou op om jou soos jou pa te gedra. Anyways.
Jy het met hom getrou.
Ja, wel, exactly. Dan leer hulle vir jou van wetenskap en osmose. Hou jou mond en eet jou kos klaar. So, daar is ook een ander wat ek gereeld gekry het. Hulle leer jou van uithou vermoë. Jy sal by hierdie tafel sit, totdat jy al jou spinasie opgeëet het.
Alles. So, elke laaste ertjie.
Jy sien, dis 'n groot ding, nê? Dit is wat ons maas gedoen
aan hierdie tafel.
Ja, ja. Hulle het daar gesit. Hulle het net soveel uithou vermoë gehad soos ons. Mm, hulle het daar gesit.
Indeed.
Maar wat kry vandag se kinders? Jy moenie worry nie, Jannie. Ons weet jy hou nie van...
Is okay, kom, mama maak okay. Vir jou 'n smoothie. Ja. Mama weet jy hou nie van spinasie nie, mama maak vir jou 'n smoothie.
Kom ons maak, kom ons kry vir jou McDonald's. hulle leer jou van sintuie, kinders word gehoor en nie gesien nie. Mm-hmm. Hulle leer vir jou van humor, hou aan lach, dan gee ek vir jou sommer iets om te huil ook, om oor te huil ook. Dan... Leer hulle
en wat was die ou, die, ek love die Afrikaanse slagspreek van lekker lach kom lekker huil, nê? Nee?
Ja,
hoeveel keer het jy dit gehoor, toe jy groot geword het?
Baie, gereeld.
As jy besig is om kak te maak en jy giggel lekker daaroor en jy jou maai en dan sê jou ma vir jou van lekker lach kom lekker huil. En is asof sy dit uitspreek, asof sy een of ander ongelooflike bo hemelse krag het. En dan binnen soos 2 minute gebeur daar iets en jy huil.
Ja. Nee, let, maar ek het altyd gesê, my maat oe agter na kop. Versamme, sy kyk aan die pad toe, en dan is ek agter haar rug, en dan sê sy vir my, somme klaar, wat se kak maak jy? So, ma sit oe agter hulle kop, glo ek 100%. Hulle leer jou om oor jaloesie, en ek het hierdie nogal baie gekry, daar's duisende arm kindertjies, wat ouers soos joune begeer. Of daar's duisende arme kindertjies wat nie so 'n bord kos voor hulle het vanaand nie. En dan leer hulle jou 'n paar ander goeders soos wiskunde, sit jy alweer in tandetel, logika, want ek sê so, dis hoekom, daai net ek ook gereeld gekry. Ja, en dan, ja, dit is omtrent wat ma's kinders leer. En dis oulik, hè? Ons het hulle nodig.
Ja, ons is dankbaar vir hulle. Hulle is die beacon of everything that's rational and true and ek weet nie, net reg, net vir my reg in die wêreld nog. Ja, so ander ma's wat ons ook kan praat, ons kan 'n bietjie later dalk daaroor praat. Wat ja, nie altyd hulle pligte so goed uit voer nie, ek het die artikel gelees oor Jocelyn Smith se maat gister weer in die hof verskyn.
Ek het gesien, en maar ek het nie maar gekyk nie.
Dis net vir my, dis vir my so sad story, sy is beduidend en duidelik en sienbaar swanger.
Mm. Ja, weer.
So she's going for another round.
Ja.
Mm. Ja, want ek meen nie sê, as jy iets nou so goed doen, hoekom doen jy het nie maar weer nie. Is my terrible. Ek dink ons kan baie by die natuur gaan leer, Matthys, oor, jy weet, verantwoordelikhede rondom al die dinge in ons lewe wat ons verantwoordelikheid voor moet vat en voor moet pa en ma staan. En ek het vroeër vandag 'n gesprek met 'n vriend van my gehad wat toe nou praat oor manlikheid en eintlik die verhouding tussen pa's en seuns en hoe pa's en seuns met mekaar moet stoei op 'n stadium. En ons het gepraat oor die statistieke dat dis nie altyd swin julle, maar dit is al bewys dat seuns wat met pa's teenwoordige pa's groot word, is baie minder geneig om as hulle volwasse mense is om byvoorbeeld hulle vrouens te abuse of hulle kinders te abuse. En wat die vriend van my toe nou sê is dat jy weet, is so gesond vir 'n pa en 'n seun om bietjie te stoei en bietjie te beklei. Ons leer by die natuur, jy weet, waar die billetjies met die kalfies bietjie stoei en hulle plek en as hulle bietjie hand uitruk in 'n trop whatever of nou trop buffels is of 'n trop bobiane, dan is die alpha male baie vinnig om hulle in te roup. En ja, hy sê toe nou, weet ons moet so stoei met ons kinders want hulle met hulle eie hoe kan ek sê die scope van hulle krag ken. En weet wat is hulle sterker as en wat is hulle swakker as.
En hulle wat kan
hulle Ja.
For that matter.
Ja.
Ken jy partykeer jou plek? Dit is, ek en jy het onlangs ook oor dit gepraat. Oor ouers wat nie kinders, ek weet nie, hoe moet my mooi te sê nie, maar nie te genoeg dat die kinders hulle plek ken nie. In die hierarchy, in die family constellations, in die hierarchy.
Matthys, dit is 'n gesonde ding om te ken, want ken jy dit nie, loop jy in organisasies en so aan in verder in jou lewe. En jy verstaan ook nie die konsep van hiërargie nie. En dan skree jy ewesklik everything is unfair and I'm a victim and I'm offended and I'm not getting the chances. And it's tough out there, man. It's tough out there. En ons het tough mense nodig.
Ja, maar binnekort praat ons met professor David Block. So net hierna.
Ja, Matthys, so almal in Suid-Afrika was ook hierdie week in absolute euforia oor die Aurora Australis, as opposed to die Aurora Borealis. Die Southern Lights, wat ons almal eweskielik kon sien, en het was vir my so awesome, want eweskielik is almal geïnteresseerd in al die celestial happenings and beings, en ek kon aan niemand beter dink, as the wonderful Professor David Block, to explain this phenomenon to us, because I've heard so many stories, Prof, in the last few days of people's theories on how these lights emerge and how they happen. And I've heard everything from magic to absolute fear-mongering, and it's the end of the world. Mm-hmm. I was lucky enough to spend a few days with you in the Arctic, and I got some first-hand knowledge, and I thought we've just got to get our astronomy whisperer in. So welcome, Prof, and thank you so much for joining us. Thank you so much for making time.
Pauline, it's an absolute joy and pleasure. The last time we physically saw one another was with a group of aurora chasers, as I call them, in the Arctic, in the Lofoten Islands. And yes, there's been a general euphoria worldwide about the occurrences of the aurorae in both the northern and in the southern hemispheres. I've been extremely interested in the solar activity. Now, let's just backtrack, if I may, and explain what's happening is that our closest star is the sun.
The
sun is a blazing ball of hydrogen gas. What happens at the center of, at the core of the sun, is that hydrogen fuses into helium under tremendous temperatures and pressures and so forth. And the sun loses about 4 million tons in mass every second. Now,
wow, that's incredible.
Really is, 4 million tons a second. And yet the sun has got enough gas to continue this thermonuclear fusion for around 4.5 billion years. That's 4,500 million years. So the sun is an active star. This is the point. It's not quiescent. It's active. You know, many years ago, thinking back to my childhood days in Krugersdorp, we I also learned to speak Afrikaans.
Krugersdorp of all places, wow.
I really...
A West Rand boy you are.
I have the highest regard for the Afrikaans language, and I understand it perfectly, is that I, as a youngster really at school, I secured special filters, and my father bought me a telescope, and I could gaze at the sun with perfect safety to the eyes. I could actually gaze at the sun. And what I saw was, from Krugersdorp, I saw the writhing, seething surface of the sun. I saw dark little areas on our sun called sunspots, which again tells us that there's a tremendous amount of activity on the sun. And then, if you've got really special filters called a hydrogen alpha filter, you can actually observe leaps of gas, which I showed you in Norway, those huge leaps of gas. Mm. And they generally go up a certain height, maybe 40 Earth diameters, and then they generally cascade down again under the sun's gravitational force field. But, and this is the very exciting part, there's something called CMEs, Colleen. Now, these CMEs are coronal mass ejections. So what really happens then is that gas is ejected from the outer domains of the sun, and it then starts traveling in space. Now, of course, once it starts traveling in space, it eventually streams of very high energy particles, such as xenon and krypton, from these CMEs, will eventually reach the environs of the Earth. Now, yeah. The Earth is very, very beautifully finely tuned, protection-wise, by means of a kind of a shield. Astronomers and physicists call this the magnetosphere. So it shields us from the very dangerous high-energy particles coming in as a result of these CMEs, the coronal mass ejections. Now, the magnetosphere, if you study it in detail, the magnetic field lines strike the Earth at the essentially at the North Pole and at the South Pole, the magnetic poles, but I don't want to become too technical there. And so what happens is you've got all these particles as a result of this very, very active sun, and which happens once every 11 years, by the way. So we'd have to wait another 11 years if we don't go to the arc.
Is that just a natural cycle, bro?
That's a natural.
Once in 11.
Yes, yes. It's really a cycle called the Maunder cycle. And if you look at the number of sunspots on the sun, it goes through maxima every 11 years and then goes down to a minimum and then it goes back to a maximum in another 11 years. It's a very regular kind of cycle. Okay. What's so interesting now is that the sun is reaching its peak in terms
of maximum.
That's right, in terms of this 11-year cycle. So you can imagine there have been these huge outpourings of very high energy particles, such as xenon and krypton, coming in from the sun. There have been these coronal mass ejections. So in other words, they get ejected into space. They start coming towards the Earth, and as they hit the Earth's magnetosphere, they follow the magnetic field lines, which, as I say, strike the Earth at the North Magnetic Pole and at the magnetic poles at the poles. Now, generally, these storms are not strong enough to cause aurora like we saw last week or over the weekend. They simply, you know, I've been an astronomer for over 40 years now, longer than that, in fact. And my first paper, I think, was published in 1974. So I would have been 22 at that stage. So I've been an astronomer basically my entire life. And what's happened now is that instead of having to travel to Norway, which is normally the case, to see the aurora borealis, or the northern lights, what happened is that spectators on Earth, observers on Earth, were treated to a magnificent spectacle, Colleen, of the aurora borealis, the northern lights, being visible from large parts of the USA. But also very interesting, you know, I've seen the most magnificent photographs of the aurora borealis dancing over France. I mean,
that's incredible.
It's really unheard of. So what's really happened, Colleen, is that the storms have been so severe that they've created aurora, and not only around the North Pole and the South Magnetic Pole, but the particles have streamed in with such with such speed.
Intensity,
that's a lovely word, is that they've streamed in with such intensity that if we look at the north, for example, instead of having to go to Norway, you've got a spillover. You know, it's just like if you've got a hailstorm, you know, nothing much happens generally. But if you've got a flood of hail, it'll just pour over in all directions over the roof, right? And that's really what's happened here is that magnetosphere is living up to all its expectations in that when you've got a gargantuan solar storm, you see these aurorae. Now, what actually happens is this.
Yeah, because that's what I wanted to ask you as well, Prof, because you had such a beautiful explanation. I hope you can give this to our listeners, because I just always find it so magic that something so violent, such as these solar storms, can cause something so beautiful, such as the aurora. That's so please explain to us, how do these lights form? What happens?
So basically, as you know, we have oxygen in the atmosphere, we have nitrogen in the atmosphere, and so forth. Now, when these high-energy particles, for example, strike, let's just think of an atom. So you've got the nucleus, and you've got protons and electrons in the nucleus, and then you've got electrons orbiting the nucleus. So it's very simple. You've got your nucleus, and you've got your orbital electrons circling around, if you like, the atomic nucleus. Now, what happens is, when these energetic particles strike, just say one atom, it imparts energy to the atom because it's striking it. So it imparts energy. So what happens is that the electron then jumps from a lower energy level to a higher energy level, because it's got to absorb the energy that's just been impinging upon it. So you've got, for example, as I say, an atom of oxygen or a molecule. And what's essentially happening there is that the electrons are in their most relaxed energy states. They absorb the impinging energy. They rise up in their orbitals, but then something very interesting happens. When they come down again to their lower energy levels, they emit light. Oxygen atoms and the nitrogen ones and the molecules start emitting light. So what we are seeing with the aurora is light emission as a result of very high energy particles from the sun entering the magnetosphere, interacting with oxygen and nitrogen, causing the electrons to jump up and then come down. And when they come down, when they cascade downwards electrons within these atoms, what happens then is they give off energy. Now, it depends on how energetic the solar wind really is. In this occasion over the weekend, it was so energetic that, you know, we got colors of purple, we got colors of pink. Beautiful. So basically, the electromagnetic...
Because that for me was interesting, Prof, because the colors I saw of people taking photographs in Namibia, in Gansbaai, in everywhere, it was very different to the colors that I experienced in the Arctic.
That's right. So in other words, with a massive storm like we had, you have excitations across the electromagnetic spectrum. In other words, blue light, short wavelengths, red light, long wavelengths. So for example, with some of the photographs we saw from Southern Africa, I was stunned to see that the aurora australis could actually hit like Gansbaai and areas in that domain. I think that's
even the Drakensberg. I saw some beautiful photos out of the Drakensberg.
I saw people noting it also in Namibia. Some people had sightings in Namibia. So it was actually quite far up north from our southern perspective.
In my entire career, my entire life. And what's happened now is that instead of having to travel to Norway, which is normally the case, to see the aurora borealis, or the northern lights, what happened is that spectators on Earth, observers on Earth, were treated to a magnificent spectacle, Colleen, of the aurora borealis, the northern lights, being visible from large parts of the USA. But also very interesting, you know, I've seen the most magnificent photographs of the aurora borealis dancing over France. I mean,
that's incredible.
It's really unheard of. So what's really happened, Colleen, is that the storms have been so severe that they've created aurora, and not only around the North Pole and the South Magnetic Pole, but the particles have streamed in with such, not with such aggression, but with such speed.
Intensity.
Intensity, that's a lovely word, is that they've streamed in with such intensity that if we look at the north, for example, instead of having to go to Norway, you've got a spillover. You know, it's just like if you've got a hailstorm, you know, nothing much happens generally. But if you've got a flood of hail, it'll just pour over in all directions over the roof, right? And that's really what's happened here, is that magnetosphere is living up to all its expectations, in that when you've got a gargantuan solar storm, you see these aurorae. Now, what actually happens is this.
Yeah, because that's what I wanted to ask you as well, Prof, because you had such a beautiful explanation. I hope you can give this to our listeners, because I just always find it so magic that something so violent, such as these solar storms, can cause something so beautiful, such as the aurora. That's so please explain to us, how do these lights form? What happens?
So basically, as you know, we have oxygen in the atmosphere, we have nitrogen in the atmosphere, and so forth. Now, when these high-energy particles, for example, strike, let's just think of an atom. So you've got the nucleus, and you've got protons and electrons in the nucleus, and then you've got electrons orbiting the nucleus. So it's very simple. You've got your nucleus, and you've got your orbital electrons circling around, if you like, the atomic nucleus. Now, what happens is, when these energetic particles strike, just say one atom, it imparts energy to the atom because it's striking it. So it imparts energy. So what happens is that the electron then jumps from a lower energy level to a higher energy level, because it's got to absorb the energy that's just been impinging upon it. So you've got, for example, as I say, an atom of oxygen or a molecule. And what's essentially happening there is that the electrons are in their most relaxed energy states. They absorb the impinging energy. They rise up in their orbitals, but then something very interesting happens. When they come down again to their lower energy levels, they emit light. So the oxygen atoms and the nitrogen ones and the molecules start emitting light. So what we are seeing with the aurora is light emission as a result of very high energy particles from the sun entering the magnetosphere, interacting with oxygen and nitrogen, causing the electrons to jump up and then come down. And when they come down, when they cascade downwards, electrons within these atoms, what happens then is they give off energy. Now, it depends on how energetic the solar wind really is. In this occasion over the weekend, it was so energetic that, you know, we got colors of purple, we got colors of pink. Beautiful. So basically, the electromagnetic...
Because that for me was interesting, Prof, because the colors I saw of people taking photographs in Namibia, in Gansbaai, in everywhere, it was very different to the colors that I experienced in the Arctic.
That's right. So in other words, with a massive storm like we had, you have excitations across the electromagnetic spectrum. In other words, blue light, short wavelengths, red light, long wavelengths. So for example, with some of the photographs we saw from Southern Africa, I was stunned to see that the aurora australis could actually hit like Gansbaai and areas in that domain. I think that's
even the Drakensberg. I saw some beautiful photos out of the Drakensberg.
I saw people noting it also in Namibia. Some people had sightings in Namibia. So it was actually quite far up north from our southern perspective.
So, I mean, normally, if you think of the Aurora Australis, the only way of seeing them is to go down to the south polar regions. But the point really
Antarctic.
Is the Antarctic, yes. But the point is you've got no hotels in the Antarctic, you know. No solid.
Even more expensive than Norway. So
well, that's right. I mean, I did see a flight advertised which lands at a certain base camp in the Arctic, and I cannot remember exactly, but it was either $100,000 or $200,000 for 5 nights. I mean, that's the best you can do. Is there are no hotels, there's no fixed land mass in the terms of habitable zones and so forth. So the only way I would ever be able to see the Aurora Australis, generally speaking, without such a massive storm, is, for example, to go to Tasmania. They often see the Aurora Australis because they're far enough south. But what was very interesting is that this time around, the Aurora Australis was also seen from Australia. So, as Matthijs has said, the intensity of the solar wind was of such an incredible extent that latitudes far away from the North Pole and from the South Pole could actually witness these dancing cascades of light as the solar wind continually streams in. In other words, Colleen and Matthijs, without the sun, there's no aurora.
Well, without the sun, there's no life.
Well, that's right.
But that's one of
I'm
the
being
critical.
Very dramatic there. But what I'm trying to say is that the aurora and the colors of the aurora are inextricably linked to the solar wind. And that's what folk in my groups don't often appreciate, is that you need two things to be operative in your favor to see the aurora like you did, Colleen.
Yeah.
And that you need, of course, clear skies, no cloud cover. But then you need the sun to really be active. Now, the sun is going through a cycle of maximum activity, but some days the activity is not as large as on other days. And, for example, this weekend with the CMEs, what we observed was a massive set of ejections of gas from the sun. And as I said, they were so massive that the Aurora Australis was apparently seen from Southern Africa, which I find staggering because, as I say, normally you have to travel right to by ship or whatever, or not by ship in winter, of course, to the Antarctic. But you have to travel there, and or you have to go to the Auroral Oval, within the Auroral Oval in Norway. So this is I regard it almost as a once-in-a-lifetime occurrence, I think, to see the Aurora Australis, for example, from Southern Africa.
On the African continent.
I
must say, Prof, I think you need three things. You need clear skies, and you need intense solar activity.
Yes.
And having a Prof block around also helps a lot.
Oh, thank you. I think that, and I'd like to say this to all your kids viewers, is that, you know, people in a very real sense, Colleen and Matthijs, have lost a sense of wonder. It's become a very mundane existence. I think it was exacerbated largely by COVID, the pandemic, the lockdowns.
True.
People have almost gone into a kind of, I would call it a slump mode, where there's no emotional real high. I meet very, very few people who actually look up in wonder and say, wow, David, it's great to be alive. Wow, look at this. And what's terribly interesting, you know, is that I'm normally interviewed on the major essay, on the major essay TV stations and so on. But the Aurora this time round has captured the imagination of the world, but I haven't seen much of it on local television. Have you, Colleen?
No, I found it actually very interesting. Matthijs, I don't know if you have, because Matthijs scrutinizes the news even more than what I have. Yes. But yeah, I've spoke to many people in my personal vicinity that were fascinated about it. But yes, it is like you say, Prof, we've lost our sense of wonder. Matthijs, I don't know if you've seen much.
No, I actually tried to have a look, and I had to go to YouTube to go and get more information. And most of it was actually from the Northern Hemisphere. Very little information was about South Africa. Prof, I just quickly want to circle back to something that maybe I didn't understood properly.
Yes.
Is specifically the difference in colors. When I looked at the photos that Colleen shared with us when she was in Norway, it's the beautiful greens and purples and whites and blues. And when I look at the photos that we have now in with the southern lights that we saw in South Africa, it was majority red. Is there a very specific...
There was a lot of pink
red.
Well, right?
But is there a specific reason that the color differences are so different? Or is it just how the auroras work?
Just nature playing.
It's all got to do with dancing electrons in these atoms, preferentially of oxygen and nitrogen, and how strong the solar wind is in the northern and southern domains of the magnetosphere. So, for example, if you've got a high intensity, and they're entering, say, the domains of the auroral oval, which is in the northern hemisphere, then, of course, you've got so much to play with. You know, you've got all these atoms, and the electrons can jump one level, they can jump two levels, they can jump three levels, they can jump whatever. And as they return to their lower orbitals, they each give off different, if you like, colors. Mm-hmm. So there was obviously, I have not, Matthijs, examined in any detail, you know, the Aurora Australis photographs. I haven't. You see, as an astronomer, I'm very concerned, Colleen and Matthijs, with AI-generated images. I'm not saying that a lot was AI here, but I want to alert you to something. I started receiving images, apparently from Norway, of the massive displays, you know, of the Northern Lights. And upon very close scrutiny, I found that they were AI generated. Now, let me explain how this works. There are programs today, and I've tried them, and you type in your computer, generate a picture for me of the aurora in Norway, show some mountains, show some fjords, show a canoe, and show the aurora borealis. Mm-hmm. And in a fraction of a second, there's your photo.
Yeah.
But it's a deep fake. Mm. It's a deep fake. And it has worried me, you know, that, and it worried me immediately, is that the images from Hanspy only showed red. I'm not used to Aurora doing that, and I cannot think offhand of a viable reason except to say that the camera sensors, which the photographers in the Southern Hemisphere used, might have been preferentially sensitive to red light. You know, there's a huge variation in what we call spectral sensitivity. And you've got to be very careful, you know, which detectors are you using? Are your detectors preferentially geared towards the red region of the spectrum? If yes, then you will start seeing a very unusual effect. You see, there's something with auroral photography called the white balance. And Colleen, you were there when I lectured about.
Very interesting lecture, yes.
There's a whole host of recipes that you have to follow to capture the correct colors of the lights. There's a whole host of little boxes you have to tick. Now, you must remember, and I'm not trying to be derogatory, but you must remember that, I mean, I don't think any of these pictures were taken in the Southern Hemisphere. I'm talking of not in Tasmania, but I'm talking of in Southern Africa on the African continent. I'm not aware of astronomers per se having taken these images. No, say a person like myself, right? Yeah. But what I'm saying is, as a scientist, before jumping to the conclusion that the solar wind was asymmetric, that there was far more intensity in the north than there could be in the south, which is possible, I'd like to sit back with one or two of these photographers and say, show me what your white balance settings were. Show me what your lenses were. Show me what your detectors were. That's how I work as a scientist. Thankfully, Colleen and Mateus, I'm very seldom fooled. And so on Facebook and on social media now, there's an added euphoria of adding AI to the images. And they're doing, I saw one, they said, just look at this, it's Moses burning bush, and it's all flames leaping down, but everything's fake.
Yeah. And I think that's what's so valuable in these tours that you do as well, Prof, is that the lectures that you do before we go out on our light hunting every night, which is very exciting, those lectures are so informative for anyone that is avidly into astronomy for years, or even for someone like me, which is I pursue astronomy for dummies because I'm still learning. And you can learn everything from your tour. And I really want to encourage, I know you've got two more tours coming up at the beginning of next year. And I really want to encourage everyone who is mildly even interested in this to just take the leap and go. It just opens your mind to magic. Give us a brief overview of what lies ahead for anyone that embarks on your tours, Prof.
Yes, thank you so much for that opportunity. I believe we only live on Earth once, terrestrially speaking, and we need to capitalize on what pushes our buttons of wonder and magic. Let me repeat that. Mm-hmm. We need to capitalize. You know, I'd far rather die with a couple of thousand dollars spent on one of these trips, not that it costs that much, but than to be buried with, in a sense of total despair, with zero wonder, and have the additional money in the bank. To me, it makes no sense. My whole life, I remember I was interviewed, I think it was Money Talk or The Money Show, and they said to me, Professor Block, how do you manage your finances? And I tried to explain that I manage my finances in terms of the magic, in terms of capturing the wonder and the awe. You know, to me, it's irrelevant if the Lord calls me home and I've got, 200,000 rand less or more in the bank. It's irrelevant. I need to live life to the fullest. So here I am as an astronomer. I've been to the Arctic probably nearly 10 times now. And the reason I do it is very simple. The reason I do it is I want others like yourself to experience the magic. And so
I can highly recommend it to anyone, Prof. It's just the realness of the experience, the ability to interact with you is amazing. I mean, a world-renowned astronomer. You are part of the Royal Astronomical Society of London, amongst so many others. The European Southern Observatory in Germany. The California Institute for Technology, the University of Harvard. It's just so amazing to be able, this is beyond YouTube. It's beyond AI. It's where you can stand next to a great mind and see these amazing celestial phenomenon happening in front of your eyes, and I can ask you questions. And we've got about 2 minutes remaining, Prof. So, yeah, I just...
What I'd like to just say...
We're going to... Yeah.
We can wrap this up as follows, if I may. And that's to say, and I've got my eye very carefully on the clock, is that live with expectation and live with enthusiasm. And if you really want to come on my tour, I've got two tours, one in February next year and one in March. Now, the February tour is full now. That's already full.
So amazing. I've opened
March. And it's in the Lofoten Islands in Norway. So how do you capitalize on this 11-year cycle and come with me? It's very easy. You just go to my website, which is www.davidblock, D-A-V-I-D-B-L-O-C-K, one word, .co.za.
Yeah, we'll share all of that in the bio, Brooke, so we'll make that available.
They hit the contact button. They send an email, which goes to my wife, Liz, and they eventually become part of the group. It really is as easy as pressing the contact button on my webpage. But I think that the stage is now set, Colleen, by means of these coronal mass ejections, for people to really want to chase the aurora. And I'm so pleased you mentioned my training, because there are thousands and more sites operated by tour agents, travel agents. Now, these are skilled people in terms of booking flights, but they're not professors of astronomy. Yeah. And I hope that has always been the reason why people want to come with me on these aurora chases, like yourself and not somebody else.
I'm still paying off the 2024 trip, Prof, but as soon as I've paid that off, and if that happens quickly, I'll book another one for 2025. But otherwise, I'm coming again. Norway's calling. The Arctic has been calling me since I got home. I sometimes wake up in the night and I'm like all disorientated. I'm like, oh my God, I'm not in the Arctic. Why am I not in the Arctic? I'm back home. But Prof,
what was your uppermost thought in conclusion when you stood there and saw them for the first time? Just so that listeners can gain insight, not from me, but from you.
Well, Prof, I shared this with listeners. We spoke to them while I was in the Arctic. For the first few days, you can ask Matthias, I couldn't even speak about it because I spontaneously started crying. And I'm not a crier at all. I never cry. Well, so yeah, it was the closest to magic that I have ever been. Well, it was amazing.
Just so look up.
The wonderful thing is join the tours, look up, and regain the sense of wonder.
Prof Block, thank you so much. Always look up. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much. Thank you both of you, to Colleen and Matthias. God bless you, and be enthused at the wonder of the aurora borealis and the aurora australis.
Thank you, Paul.
Thanks,
appreciate
Prof.
you.
That was beautiful.
And that was done now, Prof Block.
Preach, amazing. Prof. Preach, preach.
Yes.
Ek voel elke keer net, ek het altyd gesê in my lewe, Matthijs, mense vertel vir my, hulle word starstruck deur celebrities en goed. Ek het dit nog nooit gehad nie. Ek het dit wel met een celebrity gehad, Lorika Raug, by een Lorika Raug concert, ek denk ek het nog langs jou gesit.
Ja.
Het ek vir die eerste keer in my lewe die sensasie van starstruck ervaar. En met professor Block, jy weet, ek volg hom al vir jare. Ek volg hierdie ou al vir jare en ek luister sy teachings en hy die net die ongelooflikste manier om van die komplekste konsepte dit vir jou so sinvol te verduidelik en dit so simpel te maak. En hy is so ongelooflik passionate.
Baie.
Dit, ja, so ek kan absoluut net nie genoeg tyd saam met hom spandeer nie. Ongelukkig het ek nie genoeg geld om nou nog tyd saam met hom te gaan spandeer, maar ek kan almal aanmoedig. Julle gaan doen sy trip as jy 'n paar randellas het wat daar rond lê, jy wonder wat om daarmee te doen, of even as jy 'n bietjie plek het op jou kredietkaart, swipe hom, gaan doen dit. Dis totally worth it. Totally worth it.
Ja, for now, I will just look up until there is space.
op die kredietkaart om daai te gaan doen.
Weet jy wat is so amazing van al sy teachings, Matthys? Dit gaan nie net oor die Aurora nie. Jy gaan follow hom regtig en jy kan soveel leer oor sterrekunde. En net in die area wat jy is, of jy in Pretoria sit of in Johannesburg sit of in die Kaap sit of in Australië sit of waar ook al jy sit. Hy gee regtig vir jou key skills om met 'n nie eers 'n teleskoop nie, met 'n klein verkyker of just to look up. Kan jy soveel goed raak sien wat altyd daar was en jy dit was daar, jy het genotis, maar jy het dit nie gesien nie. En dan eweskielik begin jy hierdie goed sien en ja, he really is I appeal vir my tot almal op die spectrum, soos ek sê, van PhD astronomy studente kan iets by hom leer tot ek en jy wat absolute leuke is in astronomy. Hy kan ons interest ook aanwakker. En Matthys, weet jy wat is 'n baie ding, 'n baie ware ding wat hy gesê het wat ek wil uitlig is nou gaan ek dalk nou weer bitch and moan oor die media, maar hierdie ding van hierdie wonderlike ding het gebeur en ons sien nie genoeg van dit in die media nie. Ek dink ons is so paralyzed op die oomblik deur ons verkiesing en alles wat gebeur in die politiek en ja. En ek dink dit was die perfekte geleentheid vir ons media om ietsie regtig amazing, iets wat een keer elke 11 jaar moontlik. Is nie garantie dat dit elke 11 jaar gaan gebeur nie. Elke 11 jaar moontlik gaan gebeur en dit het gebeur en ek dink ook ons soveel meer education gewees het. Ek dink hierdie was 'n perfekte geleentheid om van ons kinders geïnteresseerd te kry in sterrekunde. In die werkings van al hierdie celestial bodies en ja, jy sê Matthys, betamal moet ons dalk net ons fokus 'n bietjie skuif in daai dag wat jy wakker word en jy's nie lus vir die dag nie. Want al hierdie kaktake lê voor jou, skuif dalk 'n bietjie jou fokus en ja, fokus op 'n bietjie magic.
Look up. Wel, ek kan vir jou wys hoe like my Aurora, want dis omtrent die stadium al wat ek kan bekostig. So, daai is my Aurora, Areola. Dit is
Aurora Areola, sê jy, is wat jy hom noem.
Ek
glo, it's definitely art, Matthys. Daai gaan ek gaan 'n plekkie loslaan in een of ander postmodern art museum.
Word jy so gepraat van titties, die wat dit nou nie gesien het nie. Colleen verduidelik vir hulle wat hulle gesien. As jy nou geluister het.
Is 'n foto van Matthys se spectacular nippel. Met 'n bietjie borshare in die agtergrond, soos dit enige goeie man betaam. En dan is daar soek 'n skorrels van kleure. Is nou nie heeltemal die groen en die pers en die geel van die Aurora's nie, but you know what?
I'm going to give it to you. Dankie. Okay. Ja, so as jy nie dit kan bekostig het om dit saam met Blak te gaan kyk nie, of jy kon dit nie oor die naweek gesien het nie, ja, kan jy nou myne sien. Kan jy dit
ek hou van daai een, Matthys, save hom vir ons, ek wil hom uitprint en hom dalk raam en hom hier teen al my muur hang wat ek beplan vir al die freaky artwork.
That will just be weird as my nippel teen jou muur is. Maar anyways, ons kan
daar meer weird as in my jou nie.
That's true. Hoor jy so gepraat van boobs en titties. Daar's 'n nuwe reeks wat op Via binnekort beskikbaar gaan wees. Dit is die bekende TikTok. As kokke. Maar wat my oog gevang het oor die. Kyk, ek is mos stout vir 'n kookprogram. Ek hou daarvan.
Ja.
Dit voel vir my lekker. Ja, ek kan dit oor en oor kyk. Maar die aanbieders van die program is Titi en Nana. Titi en Nana.
ek love it reeds.
Hulle twee gaan dit aanbied, so hulle gaan vir jou allerhande interessante kosse wys, huiskosse wys. Obviously gaan dit baie wees wat Maleise tipe van kosse sê hulle, maar nou vra hulle waar het sy die bynaam Titi gekry? En ja, sy sê die youngsters vertel Titi self gee vir haar die naam. En in haar eie woorde en 'n quote sê, mense het baie respek as hulle my sien. Veral die kinders wat op die verkeerde pad is. Dis hoeka hulle wat my daai naam gegee het. Nou, ek het nog steeds 'n paar vrae.
Ek het nog meer vrae nou.
Exactly. Want sy sê nie vir my regtig, hoekom is haar naam Titi nie? Ek meen...
Ja, let's say, hoe lyk sy? Het sy per...
Ek kan nie mooi sien op die foto nie. So, I don't know, maar dadelijk het ek nou hierdie idee in my kop gekry van hierdie kinders wat op die verkeerde pad is. Sophia.
Hallo Sophia.
Sy is nou oor my en die mikrofoon. Baba,
nee, nie daai toon nie. Nie nou nie. Dis so cool.
Let's kyk of dit werk. Maar, nee, dit werk nie. Hou net vast. Sophia, nee,
Welkom by Klets met Sophia. Ons speciale gas is Sophia.
Hierdie is die toy. En sy bring hom net uit, as ek moet record. She hates it. Maar, ja, so Titi, ek gaan die show moet kyk van Titi en Nana, om te kyk hoe lyk Tannie Titi's. En hoopelik
kry ons
een bietjie meer. Ja.
Praat van shows, nou dat jy maar iets denk. Jy nou die jylle heep hoera gesien oor Baby Reindeer.
Ja.
Het jy nou Baby Reindeer gekyk?
Ek het hom gebinge nou die dag. Amazing. Was mal vir dit.
So, dis insane. So die Fiona, ek denk is Fiona Harvey, die actual vrou wat Martha is in die program. Nee. So sy toe nou die internet sleuths het al gekry, obviously.
Yes.
Hulle het gesearch, hulle het die show gekyk, hulle het gaan search, hulle het die tweets gekry, die alles, dit het helemaal gematch en hulle het vir Fiona Harvey geout as die Martha en Baby Reindeer. So vir die van julle wat nog nie gekyk, die doen jy afgins, doen dit nou, want het lyk my Netflix dreig om die ding af te haal. So,
maar kan ek iets sê, hulle het haar geout, but then she outed herself as a crazy motherfucker that I think she is. She outed herself.
So ek dink hierdie gaan loshande, die internationaalste, crazieste story wees van 2024, okay, van Fiona Harvey. So sy sê toe in om op Piers Morgan sy show te gaan en haar kant van die story te vertel.
Ja.
Nou, ek het die interview gekyk so paar aande terug. Oh, my soul. Ek in eerste instantie het ek so half, in die begin, ek was half aggro met Piers, want hy druk al nie genoeg nie, want Piers is mis maar, hy is 'n bietjie van 'n bully van 'n interviewer. Nee? Ja. Hy praat oor mense, hy force hulle in 'n idee, en as hy like het hulle sê nie, hou hy net, betamal is dit bietjie irriterend, maar be that as it may, hy het vir Fiona Harvey toe nou baie, baie ruimte gegee. En my, so bietjie, ja, soos op stadium, so gaan hy, but were you convicted, were you in prison, or were you not? En dan denk ek, okay, Piers, this could have been easy for your production crew to find out prior. En to slap it in front of him, to say, but we've got the proof here. So, wat vir my interessant is van hierdie story, Matthijs, okay, voor ek by dit uitkom, my experience van haar was utterly freaky. Jy kyk daar interview, I was freaked out. Jy kan nie die chick nie plaas nie. Ek kan nie, daar is geen middelweg nie. Sy is either kry ek al moer jammer en sy is a total victim hiervan, of sy is a total fucking insane person. Maar ek kan nog nie my mind opmaak.
Ek dink sy is mal soos 'n haas. En ek het die interview ook gekyk, wat PS gedoen het. En ek het 'n volg op interview ook gekyk, wat hy met 'n paneel gehad het. Oor dit. En, ek weet, jy het gesê, hy was nie vir jou sterk genoeg nie, maar ek dink, hy was eintlik briljant, want hy het al soveel ruimte gegee, om haarself op te hang. I agree. En dis exactly wat hy op die ou einde gedoen het.
As ek sê, in die begin was het soal vir my, ek weet nie wat hy gaan nie, en aan die einde van die interview, toe kon ek precies sy, maar ja, hierdie ding gaan nog uitspeel, Matthijs, en iets moer interessant.
Ja, verseker. Hoorie, maar ons tyd hardloop uit, en ek sien jou internet sein, lyk vir my so klein bietjie dodgy, op die stadium, jy lyk so half, asof jy...
Allemaal in my complex kyk, baby reindeer.
Ja, jy lyk so half, dazed and confused. Net dalk vinnige twee ander goedjies. Onthou, ons is nou ook op YouTube. As jy nog luister, kan jy nou sien hoe lyk ons ook en jy kan al die mooi foto's sien van professor Blok. Maar vir die mense wat vir ons comments gee op YouTube, baie dankie. Dit word like, is nog klein, maar het groei daar. Thomas Bishop, ek is baie jammer. Hy sê ons is hopeloos te sensitief oor die flag gewees verlede week. En hy sê, it's just unbelievable. Stick to your style. Ja, ons kommentaar was kak. Ek is jammer, Thomas. Maar ek staan daarby. Die jaar het opgefok. En ek dink nie hulle gaan dit gou kan omdraai nie. Dan ander
ek wil vir Thomas sê en vir van die ander comments ook sê julle moet een ding baie mooi verstaan. Ek waardeer julle comments want laat ons ook dink, maar die comments was nie in vergelyking met hoe kakkie land is. Ons verstaan daar's baie moorde en daar's baie verkrachtings. Die comments was eintlik maar net maybe te akademies, maybe was dit ons fout, te akademies op bemarking en op die prinsipe van hulle bemarkingskampagne.
Maar die ander cool ding is, met mense hoef nie saam met ons saam te stem nie. As jy nie saam met
ons
saam
like
stem nie,
ons like it. Challenge ons. Dis kom ons die kak doen.
Ja, en dan stuur Ryan van Australië af vir jou geluk.
Dankie Ryan. Ons het met my birthday nie.
Dis met jou verjaarsdag. So ja, dankie vir al die comments, daar's 'n paar ander ook wat ek hier gaan lees nie, want ons, so ek sê, ons tyd hardloop uit en my geduld, Sofia se en Colleen se internet. So, dankie dat jy geluister het. Ek hoop hierdie week is goed vir jou. Volgende week is ons terug met 'n baie lekker interview. So,
kyk op julle, kyk op.
Kyk op.
Kyk toe ek nog jong is, my ouma het altyd gesê, raai het vir my 4 jaar, nog toe hoor ek dit nie. Soms hoor ek maar net, ek is allemaal nie goed.